Lord, we just come to you and ask your Holy Spirit to join us this morning in this service, God. And Lord, may our hearts be open to you and the things that you want to teach us this morning, God. May we leave this chapel with something new in our hearts, God, and may we faithfully serve you today. In Jesus' name, amen.
All right. May you please stand and open up your hymnals to number 437, Trust and Obey.
Thank you. Some of you have met Bob, is it Malloy? And I find him a very interesting person. I like to ask questions about different cultures, and he's been very good to tell me. And he was a missionary to Arian Jaya, which is West New Guinea, and he was a missionary, went there in the 80s. To give you a little background, 20 years before, they were cannibals. And he was recommending I read some books. And so one of the books that he recommended was Peace Child. And so I read that one. I read Lords of the Earth. And very interesting. One of the things that the missionaries had trouble with when they tried to evangelize these people was that they had such a warped view of sin. This one particular tribe that he tells about in The Peace Child, their value system was extremely perverted. And one of the greatest honors and virtues that you could have in that culture was to be treacherous. The more treacherous you were, the more you were respected and the more honored you were. And so, if you could beguile and pretend to be somebody's friend from an enemy tribe and get them to trust you, and they would lead you on, they might do this for a year, cultivating what was a supposed friendship. Then, once they thought they had fully beguiled you, they would kill you and eat you. And once you did that, you were a great hero in their community. And there were two status symbols that a man could have primarily in that culture. One was how many people you had treacherously killed, and the other was how many wives that you had. So the missionary had his work cut out for him, trying to evangelize these people. And the missionary was telling the story about Jesus, and how Jesus was God's son and came to this earth and lived among us and showed us the right way to live and healed many people and preached. And in the end, one of his own trusted disciples, Judas, betrayed him. Well, up to this point, the men were sitting around kind of half interested and half not interested in the story. But when it came to the part about Judas, their eyes lit up. He was the hero. They got excited about Judas. They liked Judas because he was so treacherous. And the missionary didn't know what to do. They had it all backwards. How do you evangelize a people that honor and respect and lift up treachery as the greatest characteristic? Well, it's pretty hard. You see, they had a warped attitude and a warped view of right and wrong and of sin. Now, today, we're facing a similar problem in our culture. Right has been made wrong, and wrong has been made right. And and the thing of it is, we've grown up with it. Now, I saw this change in our culture develop. You didn't see it. You just grew up in it. I saw when right was right and wrong was wrong. And I'm thinking, woo! One of the big changes has been that there are no absolutes. I was reading one of Barnum's books. It's an old book now. But in that book, Boiling Point, that's been out a number of years, he said that among teens, only 1 in 10 believe in moral absolutes. Only 1 in 10. I'm sure that the number is worse now than it was then. Well, if you don't believe in moral absolutes, you don't believe in this. There is no measuring stick. There's no objective standard that says, okay, this is right and this is wrong. It makes it, it messes up any kind of view of sin if there's no right and wrong. Closely akin to no absolutes is relativism. Truth is relative. You determine truth for you. Everybody has his own version. And so there are as many versions of truth as there are people in this room. Kind of interesting. And quite confusing. And then postmodernism. Now you see, no absolutes. Then relativism is, you know, everybody has his own version. Lots of forms of truth. Postmodernism has taken it a step further and said, there is no truth. There is no right and wrong. This is where gender confusion comes in. And everything's okay. And I was asking before the service, I said, now how many different genders are there today? And so Seth looked it up, and according to one, there are 63 genders. God got it wrong. You know, it says male and female made he them, but it's 63 now. And probably the numbers are climbing. So, everything's okay. You can be hetero, homo, bisexual, transgender, and you can change it from day to day. Variety, they say, is the spice of life. There is no right and wrong, except there is one wrong, and that is there's an annoying, nasty group of people called Christians, and they have the audacity to say that they know the truth. They're a bunch of bigots. We know there is no truth. We know that you can't understand truth. And they have the audacity, the guts, to say they know the truth. Who do they think they are? And what's even worse, they would try to impose their idea of truth on us. Horror of horrors. Well, when you have moral confusion, that's how we got where we are. And then there's another factor that has also greatly impacted our culture, and that is media and the movie industry. What do you need with movies to make them sell? What do you need? Well, you need more and more. You need more sensation to keep the sales up. So you needed more nudity, more vulgarity, more violence. And then once people get used to that, you need to up it a little bit more. Because, you know, people get bored. And if people are bored, they're not going to watch these movies that are boring. So you got to up it a little bit more. And so what's happening is it's had a desensitizing effect on our culture, and even Christians. So, when you have, as this missionary Don Richardson found out, when you have a confused idea of sin, it is very hard to get anywhere with God. We have to understand what sin is, and we have to have a right attitude toward it. And so that brings me to my scriptures. Matthew chapter 3, verses 1 and 2. In those days, John the Baptist came preaching in the wilderness of Judea and saying, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." Repentance has to do with our understanding and attitude towards sin. And so John the Baptist says, let's get first things first. Before we can go anywhere, we have to understand. We have to have a right understanding and attitude towards sin. We need to repent. And then in Mark's Gospel, chapter 1, we find another great preacher starting his ministry. His name was Jesus. Let's see how he starts out. What's his first sermon? What's his first point? Mark 1, 14 and 15. Now, after John was put in prison, by the way, you get preaching repentance, it can get you in trouble. It's not real popular. It got him in trouble. He even lost his head over it. But he gained eternal life. Now, after John was put in prison, Jesus came to Galilee, preaching the gospel of the kingdom of God and saying, "The time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent and believe the gospel." So, John started preaching, and the first point was repent. Jesus started his sermon, the first one. His first point was repent. Then if you turn to the book of Acts, the first sermon on the day of Pentecost, chapter 2, verses 37 and 38. Peter is preaching. The people are convicted. Now when they heard this, the people were cut to the heart. I mean, they were convicted. And said to Peter and the rest of the apostles, "Men and brethren, what shall we do?" Then Peter said to them, "Repent. And let every one of you be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit." So what was the first thing that Peter said they need to do? He said they need to repent. So, John the Baptist started his preaching, repent. Jesus started his preaching, repent. Peter started his preaching, repent. Must be important. Now, what is the meaning of repentance? Well, the dictionary says, to feel so contrite over one's sins as to change. So, you feel really bad about it, and you feel bad enough that you change. It's like the military term, about face, you know. Soldiers are marching in this direction, and the command is given about face, and with that command they whirl. I didn't fall down. They whirl and go in the opposite direction. It's making a 180-degree turn. Now, there's four aspects of repentance. I got this from another preacher. The first aspect of repentance is confrontation. You have to be confronted. No one repents unless they've been confronted by the Holy Spirit and convicted of sin. So, you know what confrontation is. How many of you have ever gotten a ticket from a policeman? Okay. So, you're driving down the road, making good time, maybe making a little better time than you should be making, and things are going well, and then you see something in your mirror, some lights flashing, and it's not Christmas lights either. It's on top of a car. So you understand, and so you pull over to the side of the road, and this guy with flashing lights pulls in behind you, gets out of the car, and he confronts you. Now, the confrontation is not fun, oftentimes many good lessons are learned from this confrontation. Well, when we are convicted, the Holy Spirit, you know, we're driving down the road of life, and we're speeding and breaking some laws, and the Holy Spirit comes in behind us, turns on his lights, and confronts us, and we feel convicted. Not fun, but it's important. Now, some people, what do some people do when they're confronted? Some people run away. Jonah tried running away. Didn't work real well. And by the way, God's got longer legs than you. You probably can't outrun him. Well, some people get defensive. You know, the policeman comes and they start making excuses. And I'm sure policemen could write a whole book on the different excuses that they've heard. if we are guilty, the best thing to do is say, "Yes, officer, I was speeding. I'll try to do better." Usually it goes better with you if you do that. And so we need to be honest when God confronts us. And we have a revival scheduled. And during revival, oftentimes God confronts us about some issues in our life. Well, we can run from it. Doesn't do a very good job. Or we can get defensive. Or we can say, "Yes, Lord, you're right. I need to address it." Then the second part of repentance is contrition. Not the word that we use often a lot, but it works for alliteration. And ministers must have alliteration. Basically, it means sorrow. Now, there's different kinds of sorrow. I remember as a child, when I was about to get spanked, I'd been confronted by my parents, and Dad brought the switch or the belt. You know, you've been there. I'm sorry. You know. Well, what were you sorry about? Well, you're sorry about what's about to happen. And I was sorry about the consequences. Now, a lot of people have this kind of sorrow, but that's worldly sorrow. And godly sorrow is much deeper. It's a deep grief that we have offended God and we've hurt him. Peter had godly sorrow when he denied Christ. It says he went out and wept bitterly. I mean, this sorrow went deep. And one thing about it, for repentance to be genuine, we need to experience sorrow. And let the thing go deep. Confession. Third aspect, I own up to it. And actually the word, if we confess our sins, it's from a compound word, homo logeo in the Greek. It's means to say the same thing as God, to be totally honest. It's interesting. And by the way, if you make an apology, make a real one. Some people make half apologies, you know. "Well, I'm sorry, but..." I'd leave the buts off. Just say, "I'm sorry." Accept the painful and humiliating truth about our sin. When we're truly confessing, there's humility, transparency, and great honesty. Blaming other people but ourselves doesn't do any good. And when you confess, don't make excuses. And don't blame others. Just say, "I did it. I did it. I knew what I was doing, and I did wrong." And then the fourth aspect of repentance is correction. We're going to do something different. The Greek word is metanoeo. It's a compound. Meta means change. Noeo means mind. It means to completely change our minds, to make a 180-degree turn. And that is so important. When we are willing to go through correction, we're willing to make wrongs right. It's not just I'm sorry, but there's going to be a change. Now, I want to talk to you about the danger of partial repentance. It's possible to partially repent, to start the process, but not go all the way. And Esau partially repented. When he was a young man, he was flippant. He was casual, didn't value sacred things. And he was the oldest, and he was entitled to the birthright. But he didn't care about the birthright. And so, you know the story. Jacob comes in, and Esau's hungry, really, really hungry. And Jacob said, Esau said, "Hey, Jake, give me some of that porridge." And Jake says, "Well, how about a deal, bro? How about you sell me your birthright, and then I'll give you this porridge?" And Esau says, "Yeah, I'm about ready to die, so what good does that birthright do to me anyhow?" "Yep, it's a deal." So he sold his birthright. Very foolish. But later he realized the dumb thing that he did. And it says in Hebrews that he grieved over the fact that he did something so stupid. And it says he carefully sought it with tears. I mean, the guy was tore up. I mean, he's weeping. I mean, now, Esau's a man's man. And here's a man's man, you know, looks like Atlas, a great hunter. And he's weeping. But he didn't repent. He did it partially. Now, here's the thing. If this is wrong, and over here is right, and we're headed in the wrong direction, we can partially repent, and we can maybe be heading this direction, but going in this direction isn't going to get us over here. To fully repent, we have to make a 180-degree turn. And then we see Ahab. Bible says that Ahab was the wickedest king of Israel to that point. It says that he sold himself to do evil. That's pretty bad. Sold himself to do evil, as the Canaanites did that God had destroyed. But when Elijah came and pronounced judgment upon him, it shook old Ahab to the core. And Ahab, it says, God said, "You're going to be destroyed. Every one of your descendants is going to be destroyed." It says he tore his clothes, put on sackcloth, fasted, and walked softly. That means he started walking much more careful. The guy shook up, really shook up. And God noticed a change in Ahab. Maybe Ahab's over here. But Ahab never really fully repented. I don't expect to see Ahab in heaven. Then Judas, who betrayed Jesus, grieved over his treacherous sin. Went to the chief priests and said, "I've done wrong." He confessed. He said, "Here's the money." He's willing to make restitution. He said, "Take this money back." And they said, "We don't give a care. That's your problem." And he went out and hung himself. But Judas never really got the job done. And I don't expect to see Esau, Ahab, or Judas in heaven. Partial repentance may make us feel better and act better, but it's still, we're still lost. And so it's important. Don't stop short or you won't get victory. Now, repentance oftentimes is a process. It can be a long process or it can be a short process. But it's painful. It's embarrassing. It's humbling. It's soul-shaking. It's traumatic. It's hard work. And a lot of people don't want to go through the pain of repenting. And but I want to tell you, there's beauty in repentance. Beauty in repentance. It's not fun. Process isn't very much exciting. But let me tell you the beauty of repentance. It is a great cure for sinning. A great cure for sinning. People who have thoroughly repented, it's much easier for them to stop sinning. But if we've only done partial repentance, it's very easy to get back over here again. My mother has been gone to heaven for a long time, but she was one of the meekest, controlled persons I've ever met. She, those of you who are older, she reminded me a lot of Alice Fisher. But I am told, I never saw this, but I am told that she had quite a temper when she was young. And she showed me. She carried a scar from her temper to her grave. She had a scar right on her hand. And she came from a big family, and one of her brothers was tormenting her. And she was so mad, she literally wanted to kill him. And she took in after him with a butcher knife. And she was chasing him, but he outran her, and she was so mad that she just, out of anger, she slashed her own hand. Now, that was not the mother I knew. I never saw that. She confessed that she liked to tell people off and give them a piece of her mind. Now, here's one of the problems. If you give people a piece of your mind too often, you won't have much left. And she prided herself in setting people straight. But I never saw that because my mother repented. She was so convicted over her mouth and her temper. And you know what she did that helped her? She would go and make restitution for running off the mouth. She said, you know, I got tired of apologizing. She said, I realized it'd be better if I just washed my mouth, then I wouldn't have to go through all the humiliation of apologizing for running off my mouth. Repentance is a wonderful thing. It helps cure us from this sin stuff. And how wonderful to be cured. I mean, this, it's awesome to me. There were times when I'm having my devotions, I just say, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for curing me. Thank you. I don't go back to those old things. You delivered me. Another thing that's beautiful about repentance is you love, what it does, it changes your attitude. And you love what God loves, and you hate what God hates. You know, it's kind of miserable to try to follow God if you don't like what he likes. And if you like what he hates and hate what he likes, it's kind of miserable. And, oh, man, you know, I don't want to go to hell, but I got to do this. But, man, I wish I was out there in the world doing all this. And, oh, man, it's a bummer. The beautiful thing is repentance changes our attitude. Until, as David said, I delight to do thy will, O God. It's fun doing what's right. You know, the sinners say, look at us, oh man, you guys don't have any fun. You know, you can't go out there and do all these bad things. And what is there to live for? Well, they've never repented. And they just never known what it is to have their hearts changed. And so it's fun doing what's right. I remember when I was a young president, I remember there was a young man that came to the altar. He'd come to the altar about every revival. And he'd walk with the Lord for about a couple weeks after revival. He'd go back. And finally, one time, he told one of, well, Dr. John Nyhoff. He said, I guess my problem is I like sin too much. I like sin too much. Well, you know what? This young man had never fully repented. And if he'd really repented, he wouldn't be liking sin so much. Let's just say, for instance, that this big round stained glass window up here represents going to heaven. And the doors out here represent the wrong way, going to hell. If I'm headed in this direction, and I partially repent, and I'm going this direction, it's still not going to get me over here. And if I'm going in this direction, it's going to be pretty easy in time to be pulled back going in this direction. Now, we can't repent on our own. The Holy Spirit has to help us. But we have to cooperate with Him. And so, now some people, that's the problem with penance. With penance, I do it myself. I kind of beat myself up, you know. I go, you were naughty, so I'm going to, no, that's not repentance. Repentance is when God speaks to us, convicts us, and then we begin to agree with Him and say, Lord, I'm wrong. This grieves you. I don't want to keep doing this. And we begin to cooperate with God's Spirit, and God, with our cooperation, creates a miracle in our heart. A miracle. And He delivers us from the love of sin. Now, here's one thing about it. God is not going to show you everything that's wrong in your life at once. That'd be overwhelming. And so, He'll start out with some things, and then He'll save some other things that He wants to deal with you about later, when the time is right. Now, so we can be walking with God, we can be in good victory. But during a time of revival, when there is increased light, increased receptivity, the Holy Spirit may show you something new about yourself that He's never shown you before. And He'll say, you know what, son, daughter, this about you is not like me. And I'd like to change that. Okay, that doesn't mean that we have to say, okay, I'm a lost sinner and I got to start all over. No, we just agree with the Lord and say, okay, Lord, thank you for this new light. I want to be more like you. And so if this is something that you want changed, I want to cooperate with you. And so there's a place for repentance for sinners, unsaved, and there's a place for repentance for believers. Actually, John Wesley preached the message about repentance of believers. And so, repentance is agreeing with God and saying, Lord, I agree with what you say. I'm going to be honest, and I want to cooperate with you. And then he, by his powerful spirit, begins to work in us, changing us, and how wonderful it is. So, repentance is not something we should shun or fear. It's something we should embrace. Say, Lord, this is the process by which you change me. No, most of you students don't remember me, but I was I thought I overestimated my strength when I was in my 20s. And I was lifting something I ought not to have lifted. And I messed up my hip. And so I went for 20-some years walking like this. I wasn't trying to do this for sympathy. I was trying to go on, and I was trying to wait till I was 60 to have it operated on, because that's what I was told you should do. But finally, I said, you know what? We need to address this now. And so I went and talked to an orthopedic surgeon, and yes, he said, you've got a problem right here. And we're going to, if you want that thing fixed, we're going to have to take a knife and a saw to it. And you're going to have to agree to let me do what I need to do. And so I agreed to let him do what he needed to do. And it was about $140,000 that the insurance paid. And different ones of you say, well, Mr. Speech, are you going to ride the water, go down the water slide? I said, no. I'm sporting a $140,000 hip. I'm just not interested in repeating it. That's why I don't play softball, and I'm not opposed to such things, but I'm opposed to redoing my hip. It was painful. It was painful. I'm glad today I can walk without limping. It is wonderful. And I think, wow, I did this. I limp. I walked like this for 20-some years. But I submitted myself. I said, you know what? I don't want to go on any longer like this. And I'm going to go to the great doctor and see if he can't fix me up. It's going to hurt. And it did. But I'm glad now I don't have to walk, go through life limping. You can limp through life, or you can let the surgeon work on you. May hurt a little bit, but it's wonderful to get fixed up. Amen? Amen. So let's just have that attitude and say, Lord, anything about me that you want to fix up, I'm willing, and even if it hurts a little bit. Father, thank you so much that you love us. We're glad that you're not mad at us. And even though there's a lot of things about us that you don't like, some more than others, but you have compassion upon us, and you're willing to help us. But we have to cooperate with you. We can't run from confrontation. We need to experience real sorrow. We need to be totally honest, and we need to be willing to change. And Lord, if there's something in our life that needs change, if there's something in my life that needs change, help me to be open and say, Lord, anything that's not like you, that you want to work on, the answer is yes. That's my desire. Prepare us for a great convocation, and help us to become like you as we say yes. Amen.